Good morning. I am Reza Navai, Assistant Division Chief for the Division of Transportation Planning. Welcome to the Planning for the 21st Century Emerging Trends speaker series. This is a series that we invite thought leaders and leading scientists and researchers to speak on and talk about latest trend in transportation planning and visioning. Today we are hosting the fourth and the final session series, Congested Development, Rethinking the Causes and Consequences of the Metropolitan Traffic Delays. We have great speakers and moderator, Professor Brian Taylor from UCLA, who I had the pleasure to meet a number of years ago. He is, and of course, well known to many of us. He is the chair of the Transportation Research Board Special Report Committee examining the public policy implications of new shared mobility and transportation network companies. Professor Taylor explores how society pays for transportation systems and how these systems serve the needs of people. This includes travel behavior, transportation financing, and politics and planning. The session moderator is Dr. Karen Frick. She is assistant adjunct professor in the Department of City and Regional Planning at UC Berkeley. She's also co-director of the University of California Center and assistant director of the University of California Transportation Center on Economic Competitiveness in Transportation. It took me a long way to introduce Karen. It's almost everything. Today's session is webcast for the convenience of viewers statewide. The video recording will be archived on the Caltrans Division of Transportation Planning website for those who would like to view it later. Our record shows that viewers from all over the world actually reading our and viewing our archives. So this seems to suggest that we are providing useful information not only within the state, but also nationally and internationally. We invite and appreciate the audience for posing questions during the Q&A sessions. And those online, please submit your questions by email on the flyer. Let me also convey our thanks to a great team at UCCONNECT, led by UC Berkeley, who put this beautiful session together, working with our Caltrans staff. Thank you so much. Today's topic is, I'm just not going to steal your introduction, but just want to say that congestion has been basically, the topic is congestions or congested development and regional economies, all the nice stuff, is very intriguing and complicated subject. So much so that researchers have not entirely explained it until today. So we know that we have the everything. congestion has been declared detrimental to the economy as well as good for the economy. Some of the largest economies have some of the worst congestions. As one researcher said, congestion in some cities is more good than bad, and in other cities, bad than good. So with the analogy to that famous, I think, film and movie is the good, the bad, and the ugly, and that's all about congestion. The tricky part is to separate the good from the bad and put the congestion in context. And for that, I turn to Professor Taylor and Professor Frick to make sense of it all. So thank you so much, and I will close at the end of the session.
Thank you, Reza, for that introduction. I think I'll just add two quick notes. In terms of context, this research and the findings that you'll be hearing today are critically important, particularly in California, within the context of Senate Bill S-375 and AB 32, particularly with respect to the development of sustainable community strategies, and also with respect to the work that the state is doing with changing the level of service analysis. It's also important at the federal level, as we just finally have federal transportation authorization legislation just enacted, and so we have 5 years' worth of direction from the federal side as well. I'll just quickly say the second point is in terms of how we'll organize today. First, Professor Taylor will give a presentation for about an hour, 15, 20 minutes, and then we will open it up for questions, and hopefully a really spirited discussion about the good, the bad, and the ugly of traffic congestion. So please, in the audience here, please, please, please write down your questions as they come. And for our audience online, please also bring in your questions because we will be fielding those as well. And so without further ado, welcome Professor Taylor. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Reza and Karen. So you all are the good, congestion is the bad, and I guess that makes me the ugly. So I'm going to get started, and it's a delight to be here today to be able to talk about a tough subject that I find fascinating. What I want to do is the following. I want to offer some background. I think we need to think about what the purpose is of the transportation system in a fairly fundamental way as it relates to congestion. I want to spend a little bit of time on that. I want to talk about research. I'm going to give you snapshots of three projects that have been related that I've worked on. One is, how do congestion and development affect combine to affect access? How does congestion affect activity participation? And third, how does congestion affect economic activity? And I'm going to give you pieces of each of that. And then finally, I'm going to ask at the end, what would a shift in focus from delay to access mean for planning? And I'll keep that at a fairly conceptual level. But that's what I'm going to try and do. And first, I want to talk about sort of a little bit about the purpose of the transportation system. So first, I want to stipulate that traffic congestion is frustrating, wasteful, and costly. And this is obvious, okay? But the important question is when and under what circumstances is congestion merely annoying, a pain in the neck? And when is it a serious problem? And how would we know the difference between those two? So some traffic cost estimates. This is from the TTI. You know, it comes out every year, and you probably get calls in all of your branches around the state. The costs have been estimated at $160 billion a year nationwide. In Los Angeles, the urbanized area, not the metropolitan area is a little under 18 million, but the urbanized area is 12.5 million. Traffic delay, about 80 hours per person per year. Congestion cost, a very, very big number. Those all rank second. The LA Times today has, INRIX has come out with their rankings, and they say, no, LA is number one. Woohoo! We're number one. And no, I guess that's not something to celebrate. Congestion delay. And in fact, on my way here, I haven't been able to get back to various reporters to talk about that issue. So what are the costs of congestion? When we talk about this, where they come up with these estimates, what do they usually refer to? Well, the first one and the largest contributions to this is wasted time. The idea is that you have wasted time in getting to some destination to accomplish some purpose, and that wasted time is usually the actual travel time over the free flow travel time, and you get some estimate of delay. That's extra time that you spent wasting fuel, adding emissions to the air, adding to production and distribution costs, the added time involved in that, and the diminished reliability of the system, and that this may chase away businesses and residents, which may have long-term cost implications that aren't necessarily reflected there. These are all thought to be the costs of congestion and why we ought to spend quite a bit of money to try and avoid that. But I want to begin with a question, and that is a congested road system a sign of failure? Well, if you're a traffic engineer, the answer seems pretty obvious to me. You know, it's not functioning properly. But let's think about two countries, both of which are suffering with severe problems. One has chronic problems with malnutrition. The other one has chronic problems with obesity. There are two stories behind those. They're both serious problems. I think we'd agree they're both serious problems. Which country would you rather be managing? The one that's trying to cope with the problems of malnutrition or obesity? And we might think about congestion in sort of that light, that this is indeed a problem, but it's a problem that's associated with some, there's a whole story behind each of those. So we think about queues at a popular restaurant. You know, some restaurants, it's you call, it's 2 weeks ahead of time, you can't get a reservation. If you go and you wait there, they say it's going to be an hour and 45 minutes, it's a mess. You'd say, oh, this restaurant's a failure, it's a disaster. What a failure of a restaurant, you can't get into it. well, that's not usually how people would characterize that restaurant. It's the hot new restaurant. The question is should metropolitan areas be viewed any differently? Should we think about that? So let's think about San Francisco, LA, New York, Tokyo. These are all congested places. From the perspective of movement through the transportation network, we'd say, well, they're failing in that way. Well, Brownsville, Texas, and Flint, Michigan are not congested. Their road system is operating in a way that they rarely have level of service E or F. They're usually operating up in level of service A or B, so they must be much more successful in that regard. And I think that thinking about it in those terms helps us to think about means and ends, which I'll talk to in a minute. But before I do that, I want to get to one other thing to think about. Okay, you are in San Francisco, walking along the streets in North Beach. And unfortunately, it's an old sidewalk, it's a crack, you trip, you fall down, and heaven forbid, you crack your kneecap. The person with you has to call 911, the paramedics have to come and they have to take you to a medical center. And sure enough, to get to St. Francis Medical Center, that paramedic has to crawl through traffic to get there. And that traffic got in the way and inhibited the ability. You're in pain while that's going on to get to that medical center. You're walking through the beautiful Navajo Reservation in Arizona. It's gorgeous. You're looking up at the beautiful crimson sky against the colored rock. You trip, you fall, you crack your kneecap. You call the paramedics. They're coming to take you to a hospital. It's so great because there's no congestion. That 120-mile drive is just a breeze. You never have any delays. Well, those are costs of isolation. And when we look at the transportation system, we say, hey, it's functioning very well. Where would you rather crack your kneecap? In the congested North Beach of San Francisco or out on the Navajo Reservation? You're going to get medical care much sooner because of the proximity of St. Francis Medical Center in that congested environment. Okay? So back in the early 2000s, we're doing some initial thinking on this. I helped to organize two conferences on traffic congestion. One is our Lake Arrowhead series that many of you may have been involved with. Caltrans has helped support for many years on the Transportation Land Use Environment Connection. And it was very well received, and we organized another one that AASHTO and APTA helped to support in Washington, D.C., gearing up for a federal transportation reauthorization. This is very well received, and I'd written some things from it. I published two think pieces, one in Access Magazine, which there are copies up there in the front, and another one called The Politics of Congestion Mitigation in the Journal of Transport Policy. And there was a reporter with the LA Times, back when they had reporters and newspapers and they did feature pieces, and she worked on it for a while. She interviewed Anthony Downs at the Brookings Institution, who had just reissued Still Stuck in Traffic, Martin Wax, a number of other people. And she put together a longer feature piece back when people read newspapers and it was a big deal when something came out that on these issues about thinking about differently about traffic congestion. So she called me up. She said, I want to let you know, front page of the paper, our column left, our featured column is going to be this article I've been working on, and you're going to be featured prominently in it. And I said, oh, that's great. Okay, thanks for letting me know. And she goes, well, I want you to know that we don't pick the titles of the articles. You understand that? Is that I write it, but it's really the editors that do it. I say, okay, that's fine. She said, well, so you understand that I don't pick the title of the article, that they pick it. I work on the content of the article, but I don't pick the title. I said, okay, got it. She said, so we're clear on this. I said, yes, yeah, we're clear. So I walked out the next morning and I picked up my paper, and the headline was, Stuck in Traffic? Some experts say that's good news. So there are a few things I learned is back then in 2003, people were still reading newspapers. A lot of them were reading newspapers. And the other is that there are some people out there who actually don't read the article. They just look at the headline and then they start opining. So I got feedback from sort of men and women on the street about some of my views on traffic congestion. And so these are actual excerpts from some of the things that I got. This one started, Dear Professor Moron, and I have to say it went downhill from there. So this is the high water mark for where this was. My favorite one was, I don't know what planet you come from, but it must be a pretty stupid planet. And, you know, there's nothing more humbling for a college professor to be sort of taken down on that. But I think this is realistic about how people relate to these delays, how frustrating they are. And I want to think through at the end and tie it back to why there's a lot of validity what people are saying here and why we have to separate out trying to think about what delays are, okay? So now, with that as some background, I've then launched into a series of projects that's culminating with this most recent project with UCCONNECT. It's looking mostly at the Bay Area and comparative stuff with LA. And it basically asks the question, does congestion diminish social and economic activity? So with that as background, we have to think about what does that mean, congestion? So I think that to start with is that when you ask people about congestion, they have very contradictory views. Everyone has an opinion about it, first of all. If you work in the transportation field, I'm sure many people will share with you their ideas. I get lots of monorail proposals myself, but lots of ideas about what to do on the causes and consequences of congestion. And I think that it fits well with a former New York Yankee star, Yogi Berra, on why he no longer patronized a popular Manhattan nightclub. He said, "The place is too crowded, nobody goes there anymore." Okay? Now, that's exactly how we think about traffic congestion, its effect on the economy, is that businesses are gonna leave. Everything is gonna go away. We're gonna lose out economically. The place is too crowded, nobody's gonna go there anymore. And that's an inherently contradictory way to think about what's going on. And so with that idea as background, I wanna start to unpack this a little bit. So coming back to this thing I'd asked you about, what is the purpose of the transportation system? And I want to think about means and ends. And I want to say right away that we're all in the means business. We're not in the ends business. So what do I mean by means? ADT, traffic volumes, speeds, delays, passengers, personal miles of travel, and on and on. These are measures, intermediate measures of the throughput of the transportation system. This is the coin of our realm. This is what we deal with. Our job is to deal with this part of a transportation network that is connected to a larger society. But what are the ends? The ends are social interactions. The ends are economic transactions that are enabled by mobility. That's why we do this. Why we do this is to enable social and economic activity. And what I think is interesting is that we don't actually spend very much time thinking about the means that we have control over and how it meaningfully relates to those ends. So why is that? Well, first, these means that I've laid out here are relatively easy to measure and monitor. And engineers and planners tend to have influence over these things. They can have some effect on these. The ends, those social interactions and economic transactions, they're much harder to measure and monitor. And engineers and planners only have, at best, indirect influence on these. So you always want to get nervous about measuring outcomes that you only partially influence, right? Because it could be macroeconomic changes in global trade that are really affecting the transportation system. You don't have any control over that. So there's a tendency to go to those means and start to treat the means as ends rather than as means to ends. Okay, so how do these means affect those ends? Well, that is a terribly important question, and it's largely understudied by transportation engineers and transportation planners. We really spend very little of our time actually trying to think about those larger connections. So this research that I'm going to tell you a little bit about thinks about how congestion delays, job access, activity participation, and firm startups, and I'll tell you at the end why we focus on firm startups, are related in some way to congestion delays. I'm going to mostly present you data from LA, although we've done comparative work in the Bay Area. And it's just too much to try and present all of that. And that we're just wrapping up now, but that's gonna be the second part of the package. Okay, now with that as background, I wanna turn to these three areas we've looked at. And the first is how do congestion and development affect access? Okay, first is the question, what should we be asking? How do delays compare with free flow speeds, which is what we often do? That wasted time is related to a free flow speed. How fast could we have gone? And I think some of you have been in places, you know, I know that in LA, and I know I lived in the Bay Area for many years, that middle of the night you're going over the Bay Bridge and you think, wee-hee, this is so great. Wouldn't it be great if it were like that all the time? Tremendous feeling of speed and power you have. But how does that compare with how delays affect access, our ability to reach desired destinations, jobs, healthcare, education, groceries? How are we able to reach those things? So with respect to accessibility, there's a whole literature on that. I'm not going to spend much time on it, but there's kind of two approaches that have been taken. The first are place-based measures. They look at threshold, the number of jobs within a 30-minute transit radius, for example. Use the gravity model to have distance decay effects. Every destination counts, but close destinations count more, and distant destinations count less. And the focus here is on potential, on opportunity. How many opportunities are there in this area? The second is people-based. So we tend to look at this dynamic nature of accessibility. Why an older person without access to a car may not get out very much at all, but their next-door neighbor, who's a young couple with two cars and kids, are traveling all over the place. So they each have the same potential, but they're traveling differently. So, you know, to what do people have access? How do different demographic and economic and activity settings change those, affect those things? Different sets of individual constraints that are involved in people's lives. And here the focus is often on outcomes and behavior. I'm going to talk first about some potential-based research, and then I'm going to talk a little bit about people-based. I'm going to do both in this. So first, going back to that potential of an area, let's think about that. So one of the things that we really care about, and I can tell you what people care at public hearings about, are these local speed proximity combinations. How does where you're positioned locationally and movement on the network combine to affect accessibility? So this has received very little direct study, some, but not a lot, and it's super duper important for planning and policy. A new office building, for example, should increase local job access, but if the added traffic delays are so severe, it may net out to actually reduce job access, right, by creating such a problem at a bottleneck. So traffic impact analyses, in general, focus on just one side of the equation. They think about how the transportation network is affected, but not about how some piece of development may change the contour or the geography of access. Ideally, we want to consider the net effects of the extra activity that's in some location against the diminution of travel speeds and sort of net it out and figure out what we end up with at the end. And this is sort of a way that we're trying to move it now, with this research. So if our goal is to maximize access, it raises the question, are we better off cramming a lot of destinations together and perhaps engendering increased traffic delays? Or should we focus on allowing people to travel speedily around and reliably across the network, across a broad swath of destinations? And it really is about whether we put more in built-up areas or we spread things out. To answer these questions, we must ask some others. What are the relative sizes of the effects of speed and proximity on access? Which tends to explain more? And do these effect sizes vary from place to place? And to tip my hand a little bit, I'm going to tell you that yes, they do vary from place to place. So our analysis relies on two primary data sets. The first is the National Established Time Series. This has the number of jobs by location geocoded to address, so we actually know exactly not only are there jobs there, but how many they are. We even know of what type. We also look at firms, births, and deaths by location. That's the term they use. I find it very amusing. I've never been to a firm funeral, but it would imply that it would be there. We then have zone-to-zone travel time and distance data from we use the Southern California Association of Governments, their travel demand model, and we compare peak and off-peak travel times, or peak travel times to off-peak travel times. We're using MTC data as well for the Bay Area, and we're also incorporating transit and other modes into the analysis. What we do is we take what's the fastest peak hour travel mode between a job address and any residential census tract. So first, for those of you who are not super familiar with Los Angeles, let me just give you a general picture. This is a picture of the job density in Los Angeles, with red meaning more and blue meaning less. We'll have that in general in the graphs. And if you know anything about Los Angeles, you can see downtown LA there at the center is dark red, and there's a boomerang swath to the left that arcs through Hollywood, down through Beverly Hills and out to Santa Monica, where there are a lot of jobs. We also see clusters of jobs down in Orange County, around Santa Ana, and to the south in Irvine. We see some through the San Fernando Valley to the upper left of Burbank. And that dark dot out there of red on the very left is the Warner Center. And then on out to other areas, you can see clusters in downtown Long Beach as well, for example, of jobs, just to give you a sense of the geography of the region. So now we're going to ask, how do proximity of employment, and we chose for this analysis to focus on employment rather than all destinations. We can, of course, expand it. Average peak hour travel speeds combine overall to explain access in Los Angeles. So to operationalize access, I'm not going to go into a lot of detail. We calculated the fastest peak hour travel time by any mode. Most of the time it was driving, but not always. Sometimes it was on transit. From each census tract to each geocoded job location, in fact, each geocoded job, weighted by the relative travel time to each job with a gravity function, where nearby jobs count more than time distant jobs, okay? So we get this kind of weighted. And we use the, sort of the standard beta of -0.2 for employment, if you know a gravity model, and we tried a series of specifications. It was relatively robust across all of them. We also used different scales of the area of which we tested the gravity model. And we summed it over all jobs in the tract. So just a little detail. So this is employment proximity. Now it looks something like that map I showed you before, but what this says is for someone living in any location in there, how many jobs can they get to in some given amount of time during the peak hour? Okay? So what it says is that most of the highest access to employment is in that blob between downtown LA and Santa Monica and down in Orange County in the middle part of the county. Those are the two highest job access locations in Southern California. And again, this is not the density of jobs, this is that gravity-weighted measure and over the congested travel network, okay? Here is a look at the average speed in the peak hour. So you take all of the links on the network and you sum it to the average level of speed compared to the average free flow speed in each census tract in LA. And there, it's the opposite. So remember, red is more and blue is less. So the red zones are where you travel very fast in the peak period. And the blue is where you travel very slowly, okay? These two maps look almost like inverse of one another, don't they? Right? So the areas where you travel fast are up in the desert or out in the far reaches of the region. Toward the center of the region, especially where all those jobs are, things are moving very slowly. Then we can ask, how do these net out between the two? And this is a look at employment access. So this says, in the peak hour, how many jobs can you get to from any location in the region? And what you see is being in those congested areas, you have the highest job access by a country mile. So by a country mile, you have that, okay? So now let me just graph this to show you this relationship a little bit. So let's take the graph on the left. So on the left, on the y-axis, the up and down axis, that's that job accessibility score. So that's just that's combining congested travel times and the proximity of jobs together in a measure of access. And across the x-axis, the horizontal axis, that's the density of jobs. And what we see is that blue line is essentially that a straight relationship, and the deviation of those dots in there is how much congestion delay affects the transition. What we see is that job accessibility goes up pretty consistently as proximity goes up. The more jobs you're around, the higher job accessibility you have. Now let's just turn it around the other way. We have the same accessibility on the y-axis. On the x-axis, we're looking at the speed in the region. And indeed, it's really slow in some places and really fast in others. You see the dots that sort of trail up? That's downtown LA, okay? What we see there is a very strong relationship that as speed goes down, job access goes up. This should strike anguish in the fear of any good traffic engineer, right? That as speed goes down, job access goes up. And remember, I'm not talking about proximity, I'm talking about weighted with the actual delays incorporated into that excess measure. Okay, here's another way of presenting those same data. On the left is speed on the up and down axis. On the horizontal axis is the jobs within, in this case, 10 kilometers, 6.2 miles. Okay, so this is just plotting it. The colors of the dots are the job access. So the dark blue dots are very low levels of job access. The dark red dots are very high levels of job access. What it shows is that as speed goes down and as proximity goes up, job access goes up. So let me pause here and say, why do we have cities? Why do cities exist? Why do we bother to spend all this money to crowd together? Why not just live in Blythe? Or Barstow, Coalinga. These are places that are affordable. They have very little traffic congestion. They have low housing prices. Why in the world would anyone pay all this money to live in the Bay Area? fight that traffic every day, live on the west side of LA. I mean, the housing prices are absurd. Why do people do that? Well, it's providing extremely high levels of access in spite of all of that congestion, okay? And it's being borne out in these data. Part of the reason we come together, and economists talk about agglomeration economies, essentially firms coming together allow for them to relate to one another, they have knowledge spillovers, they can interact, there's tremendous economic advantages to crowding together, otherwise it would never be worth doing it. It's just too expensive to do that. Okay, so then let me go to just a little bit of modeling, some statistical modeling. I'm not gonna go into a lot of detail. And we ask what predicts job access, proximity, or speed. We just do some simple linear models here, looking at speed and employment accessibility. We tried a variety of forms, and we examine these in different parts of the region. So the first one I'm going to show you, there's not too many of these I'm going to show. But the first thing is we have just the peak hour speed, so which is the inverse of congestion. We have then employment proximity, just basically how far you are away from one another. And then up here, we have that accessibility score, which is a combination of those two, okay? And we have three statistical models. The first one is just a one variable model where we say, how well does speed, peak hour travel speed, explain employment accessibility? And we say, well, it explains about 45% of employment accessibility, except if you look at that top right circle, the sign is negative, meaning that, yeah, it explains accessibility. The slower you go, the more accessibility you have. That's not very appealing. Now we try employment proximity. We have a positive sign. The more jobs that you're around, the higher accessibility you have, in spite of congestion. There, we're explaining, if you look down at the bottom circle, about 88% of the variance with a single variable model. We can then combine the two into a single model where we have peak hour speed and we have a proximity. There, if you look at the top right, you see the sign changes. Now, it's actually in the right direction. So once we account for proximity, it says, yeah, proximity is more important than travel speeds and explaining access, but given proximity, it's always better to go faster than slower. And that makes perfect sense. So if you're in downtown San Francisco, it does have a lot of congestion. If we could reduce that congestion, things are even better. But living in downtown San Francisco gives you more access to jobs than living in Tracy, okay? And that's sort of the logic here in this model. Okay, then we did a multi-level approach, and we wanted to look at in neighborhoods, so within communities, and we'll show this graphically. This is sort of that same graph I showed you before, but notice those colored lines. So let's take the top there. That's downtown LA. That's all of the census tracts in Los Angeles. And if we look at the slope of that line, that when you're in downtown Los Angeles, being in a part of downtown Los Angeles with less congestion actually increases your access. Now, as a transportation person, I'm getting some relief here. So the indigestion is starting to go away. It says, okay, once I'm in downtown LA, the less congestion, the better. Okay, let's look next. We have Santa Ana is next. If you know that, that's the old downtown of Orange County. Those are the next group of dark pinkish dots. And that says the same thing. That slope of that line is up, meaning that once you're in Santa Ana, see the dark line is going down, but the pink line is going up. Once you're in Santa Ana, being in a less congested part of Santa Ana actually increases your job access. Okay? Same thing for Compton, which is a low-income inner-ring suburb in Los Angeles. Same thing even for Palmdale, which is way down at the bottom, which is a far-flung city in the region. Job access is much lower there, but sure enough, when congestion is lower, access goes up. So in general, what we say is living in a more congested part of the region increases your access, but once you're in that region, to the degree that congestion is mitigated or lower, it actually increases your access. And that's a kind of a subtle point that I'm going to try and pound home a couple times so that it becomes clear. So let me close this first section of this research and talk about the summaries. The first is that job proximity does substantially more work than travel speeds in explaining accessibility. And that should be reassuring for urbanists because that's why cities exist. On its own, higher speed is actually linked to lower levels of access. It's not the higher speed that's causing higher levels of access, it's all that agglomeration that's actually lowering the speeds, okay? When proximity and speed are both accounted for, the effect of speed is positive, but it's very weak relative to proximity. Almost all the variation in accessibility levels are accounted for through variations in job proximity. That's why LA was downtown was up here and Palmdale was way down here. And this relationship is more complex when we look within communities. Increases in speed actually do bring much greater benefits in some places than others. Okay, and I'll talk more about that at the end. Okay, so in a nutshell, between communities, agglomeration more than outweighs congestion in determining access, but within communities, less congestion is better than explaining access, just as any angry resident at a local public hearing would tell you. Okay? Okay, so are people who focus on congestion simply misguided? Are we just deluding? I don't think so, not so fast. Speed differentials do, they differ a lot from place to place. You saw the differences between Palmdale and downtown. But there's a big difference between aggregate access and access to a specific destination. So I've just talked about overall job access. How many jobs do people typically have? They don't have thousands. They usually have one or at the most a couple. So maybe Professor Moron is from a pretty stupid planet. And it goes something like this. So you're proposing a new transit-oriented development that's going to bring in higher density housing and some commercial around a new rail line you're building. And it's going to increase traffic delays in my area, and I'm opposed to it. If I'm settled in my job, where I grocery shop and where my kids go to school, what do I care that a new office building, a new development, a grocery store, a school is going to increase metropolitan access overall if it increases delays for me in the process? So people, once they're in a location, have a vested interest in actually keeping congestion levels pretty low, even if overall housing costs will come down and access will go up by increasing development, because the people who would benefit from that are hypothetical. They haven't lived there yet. They don't show up to a public hearing. The people who have a vested interest now do. So we have an inherent conservatism in the process that has people protecting their interest. So this logical thought process usually results in individually rational perceptions leading to collectively irrational incomes, outcomes, right? That society may be better off, but I won't be, and I'm not interested in society. I'm interested in my situation. So opposing new development in an already built up congested area may make me better off, but it may well retard economic growth and metropolitan access in the process. And that this might not be the case in outlying areas. So I'll come back to that. Okay, so how does congestion affect activity participation? So now, I talked about potential before. So potential access to jobs. Now let's think about what people actually do. We talked about economic transactions and social interactions. One of the things we can do is we can look at the activities that people participate in. And part of those activities can be measured in terms of the trips they take. So it turns out that trip making and activity participation are closely related. And activity participation is closely related to incomes. Higher incomes, more trips that people make in general. So trip making is like more is a good thing, but too much is a bad thing, like much things in life. You know, food's good, a little more food's good, too much food, not so good, right? So we find that that trip making is generally associated. People who make more trips tend to report higher life satisfaction, for example. There's a lot of things about trip making that enabling people to get out, move around, engage in activities is a positive thing. So proximity increases access more than mobility in metropolitan areas. How do access and mobility relate to trip making or activity participation? This is another part of our study. And here we add SCAG travel diary data for 15,000 households to the analysis. So again, here this is a slightly different representation. I've zoomed in a little bit. And this shows localized congestion in Los Angeles. It's pretty familiar at this point, smoothed out. This is average rates of trip breaking by neighborhood. And I was going to show another graph. I took it out. If you know LA, what does that look like? If you didn't know what that was, what would it look like a map of? It looks pretty close to a household income. Pretty close to household income. So the dark red is in lower income areas, and the bright yellow, which is more trip making, is in higher. But and it would probably relate somewhat to crime as well. This is neighborhoods where people make a lot of trips, controlling for their socio-demographic characteristics, and they tend to make a lot of short trips. Anybody who knows LA, what would you say about these neighborhoods? I think there's sort of three characteristics.
High income,
so a lot of high income areas, you got more trips. What else? People know. Yeah.
So lower income areas appear to have fewer short trips.
Yeah, so this is just green or not. But yeah, you're right. You see less that, except not everywhere. If you look, there's a lot of ethnic enclaves there where you see there's more short tripping. And the third is sort of college areas. These are places where controlling for income and household structure and things like that, where are people making more or less trips, assuming that trips are a measure of activity participation, we see that it tends to be in higher income areas and in ethnic enclaves, for example. So now I'm going to just tell you the results rather than show you a bunch of numbers of some statistical models. So what we've done is we went back here and we looked at areas that had a lot of activity destinations. So we mapped out places where a lot of people went to for trips. So it could be for anything. But we looked at high activity destination areas and low activity destination areas. And then we sort of put them on a spectrum and we took the outliers, so the highest and lowest quintile of each of those, and then said, okay, in those high and low activity areas, what do we see about travel that's associated with that, and what about access? So first, in low activity density areas, which are mostly in the outlying areas of the region, but not always. Some of them are in some low income areas, but mostly outlying areas. We find that the distance you travel, your average trip distance, is actually negative associated with trip making, and that makes good sense. If you're traveling a long way to work or to the doctor or friend's house, that takes away time that you can make a trip to something else. Right? So if you have to travel, you're on the Navajo reservation, you have to travel a long way to get anywhere, you're going to make fewer trips in general because each trip has a high opportunity cost. Okay? The second thing is that in outlying areas, local congestion, so think of this as suburbs with a lot of congestion, congestion is negatively associated with trip making. Aha! So this is sort of validation to our life's work here, is that we, just as we thought, that we find that people are making fewer trips, and again, when I say that, I mean statistically controlling for income and education, household structure, things we know affect trip making. After we control for that, we see less trip making associated with local congestion. So you've got a congested suburb, you've got less trip making. Now let's look at the mostly central high activity areas. This is Santa Monica, West Hollywood, downtown, densely developed areas of Long Beach and Orange County. Again, trip distance is negatively associated with trip making. So whether you live out in the burbs or in the central city, if you're making a lot of long distance trips, you're making fewer trips. However, traffic congestion has no effect on trip making, none. No matter how severe the question is, the congestion is, the actual number of trips that people are making is unaffected by it. What's going on? How is that possible? How could heavy congestion not have an effect on trip making in a central area? Any ideas? Yeah?
A lot of the distances are so close that the congestion is less of a factor.
I live a mile and a half from the UCLA campus in an incredibly congested area. My free flow travel time to work is 9 minutes. My congested travel time is 12. Okay? It does increase the travel time. If I were going 90 and 120, it would be a big difference, right? It just doesn't affect things very much. Everything is very close together. So what it is it's suggesting that in those built-up areas, when we've added all that extra development, we've created so many new destination opportunities that it outweighs or at least cancels out the delay effects of adding that development so that overall people's activity in society is not affected by it. So living in Manhattan, living in San Francisco, living in Tokyo, Mexico City, these are places that are very congested, but there's so much activity going on, people's actual activity participation is unaffected by congestion. Okay? Out in the burbs, that's not the case. Okay, so now we did the same thing where we looked at mode, and in the outlying areas, driving, whether or not you drive or travel by another mode, has no effect on trip making. Walking has no effect on trip making. In fact, modal differences don't have a lot of effect on trip making. When you're out in the burbs, walking to a destination, not taking your dog for a walk or going, walking to a destination may be not a very viable opportunity. And driving, everybody drives. So it may not have much effect one way or the other. In those mostly central high activity density areas, driving is actually associated with making fewer trips, not more. So you live in San Francisco, if you're getting in your car and driving, you're actually, that person is making less trips than someone who's traveling around on public transit or walking in general. Walking is associated, in other words, a household that makes at least one trip from their house to another address during a day, on average makes more trips, not less. Okay? So we have walking has no effect out in the suburbs. In the central city, it's actually associated with making more trips. We're seeing the effects of congestion being very different on activities in outlying areas in central cities. Very, very different. Okay? So this raises the question about good congestion or bad congestion that Reza had mentioned. So we can think about two extremes. Manhattan, there are a lot of choices. Very dense. My sister lives right near here. Very dense, very congested, lots of opportunities at destinations and ways to travel. Suburban Houston, few travel choices, okay? Manhattan, you can walk, bike, bus, subway, taxi, or drive, and people do all those things. In Houston, not a lot of choice, and I say that with some trepidation because one of my former students is the vice president of Houston Metro, and he's doing his best, but it's a tough hill to climb. Okay, so what about LA? Well, I think in LA we can say that some places are Manhattan-like and some are Houston-like. In some places, congestion just makes people worse off because they really don't have any choice but to drive in the car to the destination. In some places, it doesn't appear to have much effect at all because there are so many options and way to get around. So to conclude this, I want to argue it's not the congestion that's good, but some neighborhoods can cope with congestion by means other than just simply increasing road capacity, providing alternative modes, allowing for dense mixed-use development, which creates more access opportunities nearby, and perhaps encouraging more localized social networks, empowering individuals to make choices about how to get around. A lot more choices in those environments. Okay, last thing, and this is the one I'll spend the shortest amount of time on, is how congestion affects economic activity. Okay, now we're turning from households to firms. Firm location decisions, and this is getting into a new area. I've learned a lot working with some regional economists in this area. Firm decisions are sticky, okay? Why is the Caltrans headquarters right here? Well, it's across from the Capitol, and it's this beautiful building. I really like this room, by the way. I'm very impressed with what you've done with this. As I said, this has hippified this building in ways I hadn't thought was possible. I just feel trendier being in here. I don't know about you guys, But in general, once you've established here, if Caltrans is going to relocate its headquarters, it's a big decision. It's very sticky, right? There's a lot of costs in making any kind of a move. Same thing with firms. So one of the things we don't want to look at in analyzing congestion's effects on firms is when you look where they're located, well, they might have gone there, and now they feel like it takes a lot for me to move. Congestion's gotten worse. It's really having a negative effect on me. But it's going to take a lot for me to decide to move. However, what you can do is look at how it affects new firms and the choices about where they locate. Okay? These are the firm births part. And we actually did something where we did a lag where we looked at 1 and 2 years later. So in other words, what was the question, congestion a year or two ago to a firm that started today? Because that was the congestion that affected their decision. By the time they move in and start a business, they need a year or two to do that. So we looked at that effect and how it affects travel choices. And we also focused on what are called basic or tradable industries. These are the industries that export and drive your economy. So a subway sandwich shop, a local gas station, those things don't drive the economy. They are supporting the economy. Those are called non-basic parts of the industries. It's things like entertainment industry in Los Angeles and IT in the Bay Area, government in Sacramento, right? A lot of your activities are exported to other parts of the state. And in that way, it generates income for the region. So what is the role of transportation now in activities? I talked about for individuals. Well, you move raw materials to factories, labor to and from work sites, inputs and outputs along supply chains, consumers to services, and products to consumers. All of these things happen as a result of the transportation system. So there's some theories about proximity and congestion, and the term they use in the economics literature is agglomeration, a cluster of similar firms. It's central to economic performance. As I mentioned, it's one of the main reasons why cities exist. By clustering, many firms can reduce the cost and increase the efficiency in accessing industry-specific workers, knowledge, and suppliers. And in higher end industry, this is really important. So in Silicon Valley, access to other links of firms, to people with high degree of human capital in the sort of the IT industry is really important. You want to be right there in the action with all of those folks. The transportation network directly affects these, both in access to workers, knowledge, and suppliers. So traffic congestion should be an economic drag by inhibiting these interactions and transactions, right? It stands to reason. So we use some more data, the National Establishment Time Series I mentioned earlier. We use the zone-to-zone travel data, and we pulled in American Community Survey data for this as well. This is a look, again, at that distribution of jobs in LA. I'm going to show you some other maps in a second that break it down by sector. We looked at advertising, apparel manufacturing, entertainment, grocery stores, information technology, and securities and commodities. We looked at grocery stores kind of as a control. That's a non-basic industry, right? It exists apart from those exporting activities. And we should see different things in terms of clustering. So I tried to squeeze these on here. So the top one there is advertising. And you can see that there is a cluster of advertising kind of along that employment belt between downtown and West LA, down in Orange County, a few other spots. Apparel employment is much more distributed. Can you see that? Although it exports, it's a low-wage sector. There's lots of apparel manufacturing. It's spread more evenly around the region. Down at the bottom is entertainment. We see it very concentrated along that arc between Santa Monica and downtown, but also up into the valley and then distributed around the San Fernando Valley. Okay. Grocery stores are at the top. You see how different they look than everything else? Just as we'd expect, the grocery stores are distributed around the region. You don't want a grocery store district downtown. It's like, okay, we're going to go shopping. Let's see, that shoots Saturday. Okay, we're going to go all the way up into downtown to our grocery shopping. IT employment in LA is quite distributed. And in fact, it's much lower wage than IT employment in the Bay Area. It's a different role it plays. The Bay Area is much more concentrated. And at the bottom is securities, banking. And you also see that it's somewhat more distributed, but it does have concentrations as well, as I'll show in a minute. So we estimated a firm startup location model. For those of you who are interested, we used a zero-inflated negative binomial logistic regression model, which is a count model that accounts for the fact that most of the outcomes are a zero. We wanted to test how congestion and other control variables affect the location of new firms. And we theorized that basic firms should locate where their access to similar firms is the greatest. So I'm trying to think of ways to show these model results so I don't show you a lot of numbers with asterisks next to them. Let's start out with IT firms, okay? What we've done there, the dark blue bar represents the 5% of the zones that have the highest average speed. So that's the least congestion. And the light blue bar would be the 5% of the zones with the lowest average speed. And then we say, where are there startups in IT? And those are error bars there. And essentially, there's no difference between those, statistical difference between those two bars. And we can conclude that speed has no effect on firm startups. So whether there's congestion or not, there's no effect on startups. For securities, we look again, no effect on startups. The presence of congestion does not affect the location choice of startups. With advertising firms, no effect on startups. There is one exception. We did find that with entertainment, we did see that there was more growth of startups in areas that were lower congestion. Now, when you get down to this level of analysis, we then want to look and say, well, what was going on during the entertainment industry? Where is the growth? And we believe a lot of it is it was growth in the San Fernando Valley and a big expansion of Disney and other things that are in lower congested areas that may have resulted for that. Bay Area as well, we look at entertainment, we see Skywalker Ranch out in Marin County. So you can start to get down to individual things that could be going on. Now let's look at what these two on the left are. How many employees in that sector are within 1 kilometer of your new business? So in other words, did you locate where there are a lot of other employees? And this is the blue is a lot of other employees in that sector, and the light blue is very few employees in that other sector. We see that, in fact, being located near other security firms is strongly associated with the birth of a new, IT firm. Down here, not only being within 1 kilometer of, which is walking distance of a firm, also within 3 miles of a firm, has an effect. So securities firms like to locate near other securities firms. So there's evidence of agglomeration. An advertising firm, being walking distance doesn't make a difference, although research in New York, as I was telling Juan, New York City shows that Madison Avenue, the rent gradient can be measured in meters, that the top advertising firms all locate essentially on top of one another, and they pay high rent premiums to do that because it's considered an advantage of being there at the center. With entertainment, we see actually being near other entertainment firms is really strong. So we see universally proximity is explaining firm startups, with the exception of entertainment, where we do see an effect of congestion, and we're going to try and explore that a bit more. So what do we find here? We see no evidence that, excuse me. That was open.
No, I opened it.
You opened it, okay, good. Don has a low opinion of my wrist strength, so I... We find no evidence that congestion levels are pushing new startups to less congested parts of LA, with the possible exception of entertainment industry. And across all the other industries we checked, we didn't see that. And it may be firms in tradable industries are indeed influenced by congestion, but the congestion actually makes them crowd together more, right? Rather than... So if you're a new firm and you're going to locate in IT in the Bay Area, you'd say, I got two choices. I got to locate in San Francisco or preferably in Silicon Valley. Congestion is really bad there, so I really have to pay a rent premium to be right next to, right between Apple and Google. And I'm going to pay a rent premium to be there because the congestion has actually made it more important to crowd in. So that's one possible outcome. Or it could be that apart from that congestion, it's just important, more important that proximity is giving more access than is the transportation system, which I've just said there. So we're extending this analysis to the San Francisco Bay Area, where the IT industry is critically important. And there's an important caveat here that we weren't able to do. We can't we only examine the location of new startups within a region, but not whether congestion may push firms out of the region entirely. And that's a reasonable thing to consider. Okay? So this is a step in this analysis. But it could be that people say, it's too expensive in LA or the Bay Area. It's too congested. I'm moving to Orem, Utah, or Austin, Texas. Although if you've looked at real estate prices in Austin, Texas, it's not so attractive. Okay, so now let me talk a little bit about implications for all of this. So I've tried to make the argument that congestion is a symptom of success and not a cause of failure. It doesn't mean congestion is good, but it means it tends to be associated with, it's a country that's coping with obesity as opposed to malnutrition. Our current focus on the transportation side has typically been on one side of the equation, on traffic impacts. This implies that we are, in general, shifting development from central to peripheral areas, and we may, by not wanting to degrade level of service, of course things are changing now in state law, but degrade level of service, and in doing so, we may actually be lowering access in the process, not increasing it. Decreasing overall accessibility, at least some of the time. Okay, so am I standing up here saying, don't worry about congestion. It's a sign of success. Of course not. Recall that within a given area, access is greatest where delays are lowest. So in Santa Monica and in downtown LA, in San Francisco, in Santa Clara, the less congested parts of those places have higher access than the more congested parts. So if we do our job and can reduce delays by one means or another, or provide more options for people to get around, we can actually make things a lot better off. And recall also that individuals can and often are made worse off even if overall access is improved. So if we want to make society better off by increasing access, we have to think a lot about how we're affecting the people who are already there and how they might feel about it. So aggressive traffic mitigation can minimize sort of losses for people who are there in the process. Now, what would it take to move some of these? This is very academic research to practice, but I think it has practical implications. What would it take to kind of shift from traffic impact analysis to accessibility impact analysis? We could, first of all, we've looked at a whole region. Instead, you start to look at specific development proposals and their effects both on traffic delays and on access at the margin rather than broadly. So we'd say, new development proposal, what will happen to grocery shopping access? What will happen to recreational access? What will happen to employment access as a result of this when we net out increased traffic delays but increase proximity as well? We would consider a broader array of destinations. Now, the whole analysis I showed you was just access to employment, right? It was a big exercise to do that. You'd also want to consider shopping, recreation, education, healthcare, and all the other things that people need to get to. We'd have to develop standard ways to measure the results and display results in a meaningful way to elected officials, media, and the public. We've struggled with ways to kind of represent some of these things and show you, and it wasn't always the most intuitive way to do that. We have to think about how to do that. So a robust evaluation network framework should not show that all new development increases accessibility, because it likely wouldn't. So there are places where you could have severe traffic congestion where additional development could bring traffic to a standstill and actually lower access overall as a result. Nor should it show that all new development in outlying areas decreases accessibility. That should only be the case if it exacerbates congestion. So if there's a lesson from this, is that adding new development in already congested suburban areas almost certainly makes individuals and society worse off. Adding new development in non-congested suburban areas is a likely winner. In a central area, adding new development in a congested area is probably more often than not going to increase overall access. And that's sort of the rub of the analysis. Okay, so if in general access-focused development impact analysis would bring economic and social impacts of agglomeration, which is, as I mentioned, why cities exist, squarely into the equation, we would see a different netting out. We can think of it as, I'm not in any way suggesting we stop doing traffic impact analysis, but it should be on the one hand, on the other, put it together and figure out what we're doing for access overall. So what are some of the implications? Selective road capacity enhancements, road and parking pricing to manage demand, investments in alternative travel modes and built-up areas, check, check, and check again. These are all reasonable things to do. But should development proposals in already built-up congested areas be categorically rejected because they exacerbate traffic? Even if they make local residents really angry. Not so fast. Thank you. I want to quickly thank the funders for this. It actually was a multi-year process. The John Randolph and Dora Haynes Foundation has funded some of this research. Caltrans has generously funded this research through initially the University of California Transportation Center, and most recently the University of California Center on Economic Competitiveness and Transportation. And I want to thank my co-authors. Andrew Monshine is a former student. He's now an assistant professor at the University of Virginia. Tanner Osman, who's our regional economist, and he's a postdoctoral scholar in the Lewis Center, which I direct at UCLA. And Trevor Thomas is a PhD candidate and spatial analyst extraordinaire. So this is the group, and I want to thank you very much, and I'm happy to answer questions as we go forward.
Thank you, Brian, for a very excellent and fascinating presentation. What we'd like to do is start with questions from the audience.
And for those of you that are listening in, thank you. I know it can be a little challenging to, you know, be part of a webinar. But if you have questions for those of you in the on the internet audience, if you could email them in to ucconnect@berkeley.edu. And so let's take the first question from the audience. Yes, sir. And if you could identify your name, state your name and your organization, that would be wonderful.
Leonard Seidson. I'm here in Caltrans in transportation planning, and I do a lot of transportation modeling. A conclusion I derived from your talk here, which I appreciated, is forget congestion, forget miles, worry about travel time. Mm-hmm. Okay, they're kind of contradictory, as you've been showing all the way through here. And so, and your conclusion about access being the critical issue is really a measure of travel time.
Yeah, it's fundamentally can be operationalized in terms of travel time, but you can come up with a more generalized measure that can include the cost and uncertainty and other things, but it's a generalized cost of travel, yeah.
Right, and travel time will dominate that.
It dominates,
and
absolutely.
If you get some high costs, that can mm-hmm. change it as well. And I'll note that last week we had representatives from City Labs talking about the new module they're adding to their transportation modeling software. Well, they call it sugar, but it's all about estimating accessibilities.
Mm-hmm. Other questions?
I'm Lindell Price, and I'm on the Transportation Committee of the El Dorado County Commission on Aging. Mm-hmm. And my question is about the definition of congestion, where it's compared with the free flow travel time or speed. And the free flow travel time or speed strikes me as somewhat arbitrary. If the road is designed, signal timing, whatever, for 45 miles an hour, you'd have one free flow travel time. If it's designed for 20 miles an hour, you'd have a different free flow travel time. And I'm wondering how that, the arbitrary aspects of that figure into the whole concept of
the measured delay is usually relevant to what's on that particular link. So whatever would be the normal free flow travel time on that link, and it could be, I mean, essentially traffic can be, your speed can be affected by the vehicle in front of you, or you're in car following mode, or it can be affected by something else, the speed limit, what you feel is safe, traffic signal phasing, a variety of other things. So we take the situation where what the travel speed would typically be when you're not being influenced by the vehicle in front of you and compare it by the situations where your speed is being. So it is all relative. So when we aggregate that delay, and we what's somewhat unusual here is rather than looking at the whole network, we were taking geographies and saying what's the average level of delay over that. And if it was a slower speed on a speed with 25 miles an hour, a slower speed with 50, we're just taking the average delay difference and then summing it for the area to get. But you're right, it varies from a freeway to a local street. But in each one of them, you can say what's the delay from traffic relative to what the free flow speed would be on that link.
I'm wondering in terms of how this impacts policy, because policy impacted the way the road was designed, whether it was designed and signals timed for, say, 45 miles an hour, or whether it was designed for 20 miles an hour. That's
how I understand the. I'm sorry, I don't mean to be dense. So say again what you're.
I'm wondering about the policy implications on the measure of congestion. You were looking at what actually exists,
right?
But policy decisions determined how those roads were built.
When local officials adjust the speed limit on things, it can have an effect on the delay, but it's not. I'm still not understanding your.
My question isn't about the speed limit per se, the legal speed limit, but how the road was designed. Say, if the signals were timed as they are on one street in San Francisco for 13 miles an hour, then the free flow travel speed
is 13 miles an hour.
Yeah. Okay. But there are other techniques such as narrower lanes, shorter blocks, and so forth that impact the speed that people drive regardless of law enforcement. And
right.
So I'm wondering how one road might be considered congested because the free flow travel speed is less, whereas another road that is designed
that. Okay.
To always
yes.
be at
right.
a lower
so
speed.
So you could, for example, there are neighborhoods in West Los Angeles where the neighbors have gotten the signal timing to be such that it actually maximizes delays. The goal is to discourage travel on certain routes, and that they arbitrarily hold traffic at intersections for a long time to frustrate drivers and get them to take other routes. So what we've done essentially is to take what the midday or off-peak travel, average travel speed of people moving through the network, and compare it to the peak hour. So we actually didn't get into the detail of what the various policies were. All we did is compare the differential between the peak, sometimes it's AM in some places, sometimes it's PM in other. We took the peak direction and the peak hour, just compared it to what it was midday. So in your example, if it was only 13 miles an hour, but if people were able to move that in the off peak at 13 miles an hour, we'd be comparing the peak, the delay to that other time. So you're absolutely right, is that there is a policy element that is important there that I didn't really address.
Okay. We have a question from our internet audience. Mm-hmm. Robert Bregoff from District 4 has emailed in this question. Can you clear this up? In the LA jobs proximity data, is there
Is there data for automobiles only, or is there transit access data too?
So the final results of this analysis include transit travel times, and for the Bay Area, the MTC model data output were easier to work with. I believe the model results I showed you included transit travel times, but I can tell you that the results didn't change very much when we used the two. And the reason is what we did is we took from any census tract to near the job location, we said, what's the fastest way you can travel there in the peak period? Honestly, for 95% of the cases, it was by automobile. But into downtown San Francisco, for example, there are many places where it was faster on transit. So we actually used as the peak-off-peak differential the transit travel time and not the vehicle. So we weren't actually measuring across all modes. We were taking between any two origin and destination pairs, what's the fastest way you could go in the peak, the fastest way in the off-peak, and what was the differential between the two. So I believe that we did the analysis initially just for automobile travel, and we've incorporated in the transit data. I'm almost certain it will be when the report is finalized, but I'm almost certain that that this included the transit data as well.
Any other questions from the audience?
Right, I'll pitch one. So thank you for the excellent presentation, by the way. You know, we have the strategic management plan for which we are trying to develop accessibility score. So I think we, you know, this the whole analysis fits right in. And I would definitely recommend my executive management to take a look at the webinar when it's made available. You know, you have summarized the topic so well, you know, the complexity of measuring accessibility and congestion. So my question is, while calculating travel time for transit, do we take into account how people reach the transit stops?
Yes.
Bikes or by car, yeah. And, you know, the headways and so
these
on.
These are door-to-door travel time.
Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Any other questions? I have a couple, but are there any questions from the audience? Yes.
I guess my earlier comments, Leonard Seitz again, my earlier comments were more comments than questions, so let me formulate a question. And as now that you're thinking about travel time as the issue, are you going to restructure your research to look at travel time accessibilities and behavior with respect to different travel times and forget delay and congestion and forget distance, just think about travel time like transportation models do?
So, you know, first of all, I'm not going to claim that in any way we're the first people to say, hey, we should be thinking about accessibility. Not only have people argued this conceptually for a long time, as you pointed out, changes in state law, changes in the way that various kind of travel demand models and a variety of forecasting is trying to incorporate in more of an accessibility framework. What we're focused on is trying to understand whether or not and under what circumstances delays on the network do in fact have evidence of outcomes, the pernicious outcomes that we would anticipate. That is that do we see negative effects on the economy? Do we see negative effects on travel behavior? And we did find that. So we found that in those outlying areas that evidence of delays is that they depress activity participation. They, in a sense, do make people worse off. Now, the focus on travel time means that when the main way you get around is traveling in a vehicle in congested conditions, obviously the way you can address that is by trying to reduce the delay in congested conditions. I think that where the argument where you're going with that is like, say, well, let's just focus on those travel times to destinations, as it says that in downtown San Francisco, in West Hollywood and in Westwood, in those places, that travel time is loosely related to actually vehicle travel times on the network. It's related to a lot of other things, how quickly transit moves, whether it's just easy to walk to a variety of destinations, whether people can cluster destinations on a stop. They may drive and then make a lot of stops on foot before they drive to a destination. And then that's really how society is functioning. That's how we're using the transportation system. So my argument is that we not, and unfortunately it's just more of a subtle point than that we do need to think about this accessibility, and that I'm trying to provide some, in a sense, some empirical and theoretical support for what you guys are starting to do in practice, which is to think about this more systematically, but also offers a conceptual way for thinking that's true. A lot of people who have argued for this have made kind of conceptual arguments that are plausible, and we're trying to kind of test those. And I have to say, I've been surprised at how robust our findings have been. They're pretty strong. And it does really change the way that we might want to think about it. I'm also very interested in sort of the political economy of transportation planning decision making. And here at the state level, you're operating at a higher level, but a lot of these decisions are where the rubber meets the road in local governments and planning commission meetings and deciding about what goes on. A lot of cities have tried to adopt policies to encourage more walking, more biking, more transit use by increasing density and mixing uses. And now there's a lot of what I would say is understandable blowback from residents who say, wait a minute, I don't see that I'm actually better off from all of this because the way I've structured my life is actually being impinged by these increases in delay. So as I talk about that, there are people out there that are making, I think, a valid argument that they feel like they're worse off. The problem is that, and a challenge that we have is that in a collective sense, places like the Bay Area are thriving economically, but they're also struggling from all of that growth in terms of high housing costs and tremendous delay. The way we're all in the transportation business, but a lot of what goes on now in the Bay Area and LA is opposition to new housing. And we have too few units and too many people, and we have a housing crisis because of extremely high costs. We now have, I think from this work and a lot of other things going on, sort of a empirical basis for arguing that, you know, we might make everybody a lot better off by building a lot more housing in central areas that may well make delays worse, but are likely, if it happens at a large enough scale, to reduce housing costs a lot and to enhance economic activity in central areas. It means urbanizing places. And for most of the last century, we were suburbanizing places, and we were creating wonderful environments in outlying areas. I grew up in one of them. But the area that I grew up in and many other suburbs are urbanizing at a rapid rate. Traffic congestion is getting worse. Building densities are going up. And evidence is, I think, that if we're able to make an argument for urbanization, we can't really do it based on measurement of delays on the transportation network, because we're never going to be able to make that argument. And also, I don't feel comfortable saying, oh yeah, let's just build and make people's worse off. But if we have a systematic way of evaluating access, we have a systematic way of saying, well, are we actually able to get more people to more destinations by doing this? We have a philosophical and empirical basis for making decisions that may actually, in some cases, increase delay, but make people better off as a result, make cities more affordable, and actually help a place like the Bay Area benefit from its economic boom that I can guarantee you virtually every city or region in the entire world would like to trade places with the Bay Area. But the Bay Area is also struggling with enormous increases in housing costs and delays. And a way to sort that out, I think, is to think through these things carefully. So there's my speech.
Okay. Well, I certainly agree with thinking through carefully. But the fundamental importance of travel time in people's decision making is what I think you used to be focusing on. And in this case, you're looking at delay, and I can understand that a lot of people are worried about delay to get the public reaction to it and so on. But the fundamental thing that's affecting their behavior is their travel times, be it large travel times because of the delay or large travel times because of long distances.
Precisely.
But both of them come right back down to travel behavior predicted by travel times, and it's thoroughly embedded in all transportation models, network-based transportation models, been doing for decades now. And you know, the project level analyses, the traffic engineers haven't caught that yet, but the patterns there is well established in transportation planning and transportation modeling.
I agree completely. Yeah, okay. This is a lot about development debates that are occurring on the local government levels right now around delay.
Let me add one other point, because I do it all the time, and that is that emission rates per unit time are vastly more stable than emission rates per unit distance, and you end up with slow speeds producing tremendous infinite emission rates, and it gets all sorts of people in all sorts of trouble.
And that, of course, has changed as the fleet mix and propulsion technologies evolve over time as well. The case for reducing delays, I think, was really powerful, and is starting to weaken over time. But it's been probably one of the most principal arguments for trying to reduce delays on the network. I'd agree with that.
So I want to build on what Brian was talking about when he was talking about starting to consider accessibility impact analyses. And also this really important statement that he made that current residents, you know, are alarmed, and that there is pause for concern, and that they have a right to this concern, so to speak. And I think that's really important, you know, given the polarized environment that we're in. I have personally been doing a lot of research looking at conservative activists and property rights activists with respect to transportation planning and regional planning. And one thing that comes up a lot is the idea of property rights and property values and the impacts of transportation projects on those. And so I'm wondering, would there be a way to weave in property rights and property values into a more complicated accessibility impact analysis? Because as we go forward with these higher density proposals, there are some questions. Maybe, you know, changing the zoning would increase property values. Well, then that might, you know, have impacts on displacement and gentrification and things that a lot of people are worried about on the left as well. And so just throwing this out there, we did not plan this question.
Property rights, that's your department. I'm not gonna speak to that. Property values is a double-edged sword in much the way we've been talking about delay. Anthony Downs, who I referred to earlier, who did the work on congestion and stuck in traffic and still stuck in traffic, has written extensively on a variety of topics, including in housing, which is not my area of expertise. But he's argued that local government zoning boards have an interest in protecting the asset values of the people in a particular area, and that they tend to behave in ways that try to limit the supply of housing in order to protect those assets. And I'm sort of one of the lottery winners in Los Angeles that I bought a house in the early 90s, and it's now worth more than, I don't know, some islands in the Pacific. It's become extremely valuable, in part because there's tremendous pressure to limit the supply of housing in my area, and that there's a built-in desire to do that, which, analogous to what we're talking about here, may not help in the long run. A lot of talk about gentrification, of course, is about economic development in neighborhoods, and what people are really concerned about is displacement. And this is often refers to both low-income and minority neighborhoods. It depends a lot on whether people are owners or renters. So if you're an owner and you're displaced, it means you sold. And that's different than a renter. We worry about being displaced. One of the issues that arises is, in general, we find that this occurs in places where there's a consistent undersupply of housing. So you have an undersupply of housing. People move out to the fringe. It increases trip distances a lot. You may have activity participation go around. A lot of things happen in our business of transportation around debates over local development. So things that increase property values are twofold. One is that generalized increases in economic activity may increase the value of property, but also limiting supply may increase the value of property as well. And so the latter is more difficult to defend philosophically and more pernicious in its outcomes. You know, I go to my neighborhood association, and there are proposals to build apartments along Pico Boulevard, and they get the torches out and the pitchforks, and I kind of say, well, you know, we could use some more housing in the area, and I'm not welcomed back. So it's understandable that people behave in that way, but we operate at a higher level of transportation network and policy, but a lot of what we're doing is being driven by these local decisions that local governments are making around development. It's intimately tied to that. We focus a lot on the transportation side, and I think that in addition to just focusing on speed, thinking about what these things mean in the long run for property values, for development, for activity participation, and what kinds of trips they'll engender is the direction we need to be going to think more holistically about these things. And at that public hearing, being able to make an empirically defensible case that you actually are making the area better off. You actually are addressing housing affordability problems. You actually are lowering trip distances. You actually are increasing activity participation by trying to address these kinds of issues that aren't just focused on, in this case, you know, level of service at a particular intersection.
Well, and it seems to me that, you know, look, you know, because we're here at Caltrans and thinking about state legislation and what you all do, is that there's a direct relationship between all of this and Senate Bill 375 and the Sustainable Community Strategies, which the state is very involved in. So Thank you. Are there other questions from the audience? There's a comment from Robert from District 4 that I will definitely pass on to Brian afterwards. Are there any other questions? Yes, in the back.
If you could say your name and where you're from.
Chad Redding, Division of Transportation Planning. Question. So, Los Angeles is your case study for the presentation you just gave. Are you interested in doing a similar study in other cities, either throughout the US or the world? And do you think that there might be some interesting conclusions if you attempted it with another case study?
Am I interested? Yes, I'm interested. We've done as much as we possibly could. And as I mentioned, I actually have the ink still wet on the Bay Area results, but I was just worried about cramming in a lot more graphs and data. But so we have done these two areas, and we picked the two largest, most congested areas in the state, in part because we're receiving funding from the California Department of Transportation. It's about congestion. So we picked, the two biggest, most congested areas. I think that there is, from the data I've seen, that there's no question that places like Jakarta and Lagos, perhaps Bangkok, face such debilitating levels of congestion that there's no question that it exacts a significant economic toll on productivity. And an important question to ask is, when does a place like the Bay Area, LA, cross over from Raleigh-Durham and Albuquerque and Austin levels of congestion to Lagos and Jakarta levels of congestion? And there was a student at UCLA who won a national award for her work 20-some years ago, looking at Jakarta and what firms had to do because of the levels of delay that existed in terms of getting workers and materials to sites. There was so much unreliability that it increased production costs enormously. So in no way is there an argument to be made here that, we don't worry about these things and we may not see very different results. But I think that the basic logic of the arrangement should be, in what place, in what location, does the relative shifts in traffic speeds along the network and in proximity combine to create that access? That's a reasonable question to ask and to understand how it applies in different places. I want to point out one other thing here about public transit. We've done some other work that we finished for the Federal Highway Administration looking at millennials and travel, including millennials' use of public transit. And I think the thing to understand about public transit is that its role is so extraordinarily aspatial, asymmetric spatially, in that 40% of all the transit riders in the United States are in the metropolitan New York region. And the 10 largest U.S. transit operators, of which there are some in California, carry just under 2/3 of all the riders. And that in most of the country, public transit plays an extremely small role in mobility. And in some places, it plays an extraordinarily large role. And those are highly skewed. We actually typed every census tract in the country based on its built form and transportation network characteristics, including its transit service. And we found that 4% of the census tracts in the country were carrying over half of all the transit riders in the country. So one of the issues that we face is that someone may be looking at development impacts in suburban Sacramento and say, well, let's just extend the light rail line. There, that effect may be so minor compared to what an extension of a light rail line in San Francisco might accomplish that it's difficult to treat those as even similar treatments, to even consider them similar treatments, and that most of the country is built around auto-oriented urban development, and that increasing densities in those areas may well be making people worse off in the long run. And if we are following a path of increasing urbanization, a question is that how do suburban areas evolve as they become more densely developed? Do they just become that suburban Houston example I gave? Or can we make them more urban places? that's an enormous challenge. It's going to involve lots of people who are not in purely the transportation business. But I don't think it's something that we've sorted out at all. And I worry a lot about transit treatments being treated, as similar. And, you know, the question is that a subway on Wilshire Boulevard and Market Street may make sense, a subway in Barstow or Coalinga does not. And yet we often think about transit investments as this thing we plug in anywhere to try and provide alternative travel. And in a lot of outlying areas, the transit service is simply providing sort of, a base level of mobility for people because of age, income, or disability that can't make use of the automobile system. In a place like San Francisco, it's an incredibly central part of the way that you get around. And that's a big difference between those two. So that's an example of looking at different kinds of cities might result in very different outcomes.
Any other questions from the audience? Oh, right here.
This microphone has had mixed results because I hear some people and then it fades off. Maybe I'll be able to keep it working. Latent demand. If we build a freeway, we build a new lane. There's a theory that, you know, for a while, traffic is better because you have more capacity. But over time, the demand, because more people now use the system because it's bigger, the effects create more congestion in the long run. You made a comment that if we somehow were able to create more infill in the urban areas, in the cities, more housing starts, that this potentially could lower the cost of housing. But isn't that the same thing? Wouldn't we have latent demand? I mean, it's all supply and demand that eventually all those homes would be purchased or high rises, and you're still based on population growth in our state, which is expected by 2040, I think, to grow by 20 million. That in effect, that would just be cyclical and we'd be right back where we were in terms of unaffordability of housing in the urban area. And I have one more question when you're done.
So that's a great question, and I want to jump on this latent demand a little bit, and I want to suggest that you could go to any major conference around transportation. You know, take the TRB conference, and you can go into one session or another, and there is not fundamental agreement on whether more mobility is a good thing or a bad thing, and there are very few industries where we can't agree on whether our basic output is a good thing or a bad thing. And I wanna actually jump on that for a second. So
don't beat me up too bad.
No, not jump on you, jump on it, the topic. I made an argument that I think seems like, oh, there's a college professor yammering on, but that we have to think about the purpose is to facilitate those social interactions, those economic transactions. And that's what we're in the business of doing. Now, mobility, when we provide it, can enable those interactions and transactions. So can this. This can too. And there are a variety of ways that we can do it. We also know that mobility generates enormous negative externalities for the environment, emissions, energy consumption, crashes, injuries, okay? So a lot of the people in our business are focused on dealing with those externalities. And we become so focused on those, we say, yeah, the problem is all this mobility. If we could just get rid of all this mobility, we wouldn't have those emissions, we wouldn't have those crashes, we wouldn't have all that energy consumption. Wouldn't it be great? Forgetting that we're actually in the business of trying to facilitate those transactions. I would say that what we need to do is think about how we can do that in the least economically, environmentally, and socially invasive way possible. But it's not to get rid of the function of that mobility. And so when I hear people say, well, latent demand, well, the road just filled up again. I said, oh, then lots of people were then getting to destinations and going to work and feeding their families and going to education, all those things. That doesn't mean that we don't have to cope with those emissions and has to cope with that energy consumption and the safety issues and all those externalities. But if we start to focus on things like that, we're in the business of actually trying to see that outcome as negative. And what we need to do is see those negative externalities as negative. The emissions are negative. The crashes are negative. The consumption of non-renewable resources are negative. The actual physical movement is not negative. It enables positive things to happen. So We can have those trips be made by foot. We can have them be made on public transit, on bicycle, and by car, and hopefully by car, and one that's clean and safe. And that's focusing on those externalities. But if we follow that logic of latent demand, so what does latent demand say? So let's think about that, is that I really like a fish taco place in Long Beach. I love it. And I live in West LA. And there's no way at 4 o'clock in the afternoon I'm gonna say, let's go get fish tacos in Long Beach. It'll be great. Just an hour and 40 minutes later, we'll be down there. It's 24 miles. It'll be fantastic. We'll have fish tacos. We're not gonna do that. I have at times on a Sunday, a Saturday morning, said, let's go get fish tacos. And I can be down there in 25 minutes, right? Those fish tacos got closer to me on Saturday morning. Now, maybe I shouldn't have been consuming those resources to do that, but my life is better off, I can assure you, by having those fish tacos, okay? So we're in that business of doing that. What we want to do is find the least environmentally wasteful, the least dangerous, the most socially sustainable way to do that. But when we build that facility, we can say, people, there's this, you know, Anthony Downs came with this idea of triple convergence, right? So we have a congested freeway, we add new lanes, people converge on that from different routes. They converge on it from different times. Before, I was going on Saturday. Now I get to go on Friday when I'd actually like to have my fish tacos. And we converge from different modes. In all cases, people do that conversion because they feel like they're better off by doing it. So you build that, we made the expansion of the 405, and Caltrans and LAMT have been beaten up over it. Because people go out and they say, you know what, we looked at that before at 5 o'clock in the afternoon on a Friday, and we're looking at 5 o'clock in the afternoon on a Friday now, there's no difference in delay. You guys wasted your money. But surface street traffic delay on the parallel routes is way down. So there's less surface street congestion, there's less crashes on the surface streets, people would prefer to be on that facility. People, the span of the peak has shrunk. So all of those things have brought societal benefit from happening. What didn't happen is delay on that part of the network changed. But focusing in on time, people are actually able to move in a safer way, they're able to move faster as a result of that. So if our goal, and this is where I worry, if our goal is to reduce delay, if that's what our goal is, we end up saying that project was a waste of time and money. If our goal is to say, we're in the business of facilitating more economic transactions and social interactions, and many more people are getting over between the San Fernando Valley and LA, if more people are able to move off the parallel surface streets, then we've accomplished our goals. And this idea that latent demand meant that something is bad, so it is a problem. We build more housing, and more people came, and now we have even more economic activity, even a more vibrant region. Isn't this terrible? I mean, that's the logic we fall into if we start to think about those means rather than the ends. And the positive means are the social interactions, the economic transactions. The negative are the emissions, the energy consumption, the crashes. That's what we need to focus on. I'll give you one example that I think is very frustrating, is that at LAX, they have negotiated an agreement with the neighbors on 70 million annual passengers flying in and out of LAX. 70 million annual passengers. That means that you have housing under the runways, which you should never have zoned housing under the runway, mostly low income, mostly people of color living in these households, that are being subjected to enormous noise and pollution as a result of living under those things. And we've capped it at 70 million annual passengers. Why would you cap it on the positive outcome of the airport? What you need to cap is the amount of noise and the amount of emissions, and not the number of passengers. So if an airline operates a cleaner, quieter plane, they get to operate more, have more plane operations there. You focus on what the negative externality is, and you regulate around that. You don't regulate around the positive output, which is moving people through the airport. So now we're going to expand airport capacity in outlying areas so that people travel on average much longer distances to get out those, to take a longer trip up to Sacramento because you've capped the delays, and then the fares go up at LAX because you have more demand than would be allowed for. And so what I would say is we have to be very careful about sort of thinking about what the problem is and then regulating the problem and not regulating what is potentially the positive outcomes of that transportation system. We, as a group, having this transportation system, produce a lot of positive outcomes. We produce a lot of negative externalities. Let's focus on those negative externalities and not worry about those positive outcomes.
Follow up?
I promise to be more brief this time.
No, that's fine. It was interesting. So, first of all, my name is Jeff Purdy. I work here in Caltrans in the Division of Right-of-Way and Land Surveys. Mineta Institute grad. With the issue of folks that live in the urban environment, in the downtown San Francisco or the downtown LA, and at arm's reach, they have access to much. We'll just call them things. And maybe you touched on this. I'm not sure, but so they have all this accessibility, local accessibility, but they still have travel issues. They still have travel demand time issues. Is it fair to say that we still want to work to try and reduce their travel demand issues, or no? It's like if you live there, then you accept that everything's in a close proximity, but you're still going to have to take some time to get there. Or should we continue to work on models that increase mobility?
Let me try and tie it back into, I've already forgotten your name. It was
Jeff.
Jeff and Leonard's comments. Leonard had kind of said, well, we need to focus on speed, and I was kind of saying, well, I kind of like generalized cost of travel. I think there's a way to think of, I mean, when we think about we're going to make a trip on a congested freeway link to some destination, we think about the time costs, the uncertainty of the travel time, what it's going to cost us out of pocket, and we come up with this generalized impedance measure for making that trip, okay? So we want to get over to Davis to go to some groovy cafe, but it's really congested in the afternoon on a Wednesday, and so we decide we don't want to make the trip. They add more lanes to the causeway, delays go down a lot, more people make that trip. What happened? What happened is the time cost of that trip went down. And we moved to a different point on the demand curve, and more trips were made as a result. Okay, we made travel cheaper. So one of the reasons that transportation economists are so in love with things like parking and road pricing is that it doesn't just make it cheaper, it replaces time savings for monetary costs. So it doesn't necessarily make things cheaper, but when you spend money on time, it's what economists refer to as a deadweight loss. You pay, but no one gets the revenue, right? But when you convert that time to money, you now can generate money to do all sorts of things, to pay off infrastructure, to provide alternative travel, to do all sorts of things that you can do. So there are ways to get rid of delay that don't necessarily increase the amount of trip if you use that money. And if you use it wisely and fairly, you can do lots of wonderful things with it. But what we have now is mostly a model where, to take that example, let's say we say, okay, we had that causeway to Davis. I don't know how bad the traffic is. Maybe I could have a better example. But we had that causeway to Davis. It's congested in the afternoon. We were going to add a lane, but we realized it would just fill back up with latent demand, and more people would be going to cafes in Davis. And so we said that's no good. We're going to put a monorail instead. So we put a monorail down the middle of it. And turns out you positioned it right, and everybody can go to Davis as well. So lots of people come out of their cars and onto the monorail. What's the effect on latent demand? It's the same. Because now the travel times on that road have gone down, people will filter back onto the road. What have you accomplished? Have you gotten rid of delay? No. In either case, you ended up having things fill back up, but you have satisfied the demand for travel in that corridor. You've enabled more economic transactions and social interactions. It might be the monorail did it more in a more environmentally benign way. But if the focus is on congestion delays, you end up with all of these sort of wacky outcomes, right? If the focus is on accomplishing that, then you say, well, in this case, we could price that corridor. We could generate enough revenue to pay off the bonds to do that, and we could provide transit service on the corridor as well to improve the capacity, because we're not so focused on delays, we're focused on providing more people moving through the corridor.
Thanks.
I see
I think about 5 more minutes and you have to wrap up, is that right?
Brian, I was interested in what you said about airports and that whole milieu of interplaying things there. One of the things we do in our different academies, we get to travel to the Port of LA Long Beach and to see that mass. You know, it's so important. There's so much going on. There's so much demand. And the downside is all of the people getting sick, disadvantaged communities, and all of that stuff. Could you kind of explain how that works, you know, like what you did for LAX, how does that fit with the port complex?
Well, it's the same sort of thing, is that you could regulate the number of containers that move up the Alameda Corridor and Long Beach Freeway, or you could think about what you have to do to reduce the amount of fine particulate matter surface street travel by trucks, a variety. In other words, to think about what exactly is causing the imposing the costs on those, again, mostly low-income, working-class neighborhoods, largely of communities of color, what you could do in those neighborhoods to address those particular things, to provide incentives for the shippers to find ways to move their containers through in a way that minimizes sort of the environmental impacts. So you could say, we're going to cap the number of containers that can move through the port, or you could say, there has to be this much reduction in the emissions of fine particulate matter using these sensors over this. And if you can't do that, then it reduces the number of containers. But if you can find ways to shift to clean diesel and natural gas and electric trucks, if you can find ways to put more onto the rail, if you can do all of these things, then you can move more containers through. So I think that's the idea of just separating out what the negative problems we're trying to do versus the economic benefits that come from it. Instead, what we do is we fall into these traps about saying, well, it's good for the economy, but it's bad for our neighborhood. And then we have this fight over whether either or, rather than to think about how you can come to how we could try and reduce those negative costs and still enjoy the economic benefits. And I get frustrated with when we operationalize things about the same thing with climate change and VMT. VMT is an intermediate measure of both mobility and it's correlated with emissions. But we're interested in emissions. We're not really interested in VMT. People want behavioral change, that's important. But if we find a behavioral change that does so without increasing greenhouse gas emissions, why wouldn't we want to pursue that? So when we develop these intermediate measures, that's, remember I had the means and ends, we end up operationalizing a lot of our policies around the means rather than the ends. And I think that having been in this business for a while, that's where we really need to think about focusing how we structure these things. Because then you don't say, how do we balance the regional economy versus poor people in these neighborhoods? We shouldn't be balancing that. We should be, those are separable issues. And 70 million annual passengers of current levels of emissions and noise in those neighborhoods is too much. But it's the emissions and noise that are too much, not the number of people that are going over their head. And that's where I would try and separate those two things out.
Then how would you pay for the cost to do those shifts? Because there's going to be a cost.
Well, now we're just becoming, if the economic benefit that comes from having the twin ports of LA and Los Angeles is not sufficient to mitigate the negative externalities of moving the goods through Wilmington and Compton and Willowbrook and out the San Gabriel Valley, then there's a net negative economic impact of the ports. And if there is, then the goods should go elsewhere, that LA's region economy would be better off. I don't think that's the case. I think that properly pricing the externalities so that we're fully mitigating the costs that are imposed on those neighborhoods would still result in a large number of goods moving through the region. And in fact, would push us to develop more efficient and effective ways to move those goods through. Then we could have that economic benefit without saying, it's the poor communities that have to bear the burden. So I think I don't accept as a base argument that we can't afford to do these things. If we can't afford to do it, then it means that when we net it out, then the effect of the region is to make us poorer rather than wealthier. I don't think that's the case. But if that were the case, if we did a careful analysis, we said, you know, if we actually mitigated all of these effects, now the cost of moving a good through is so high that everybody's going to shift to Seattle, then we would be able to, with some confidence, say the LA region is better off by that happening. But I don't think that's the case. I think that the benefits are so great that we could easily do a better job of compensating those communities. And one comment, it's just something we don't do. Now I'm my last little editorializing. And did you forget how college professors speak in paragraphs and not sentences? One last thing about this is that we've had controversies in San Diego and in LA and other places about what do we do about airports and airport expansion, right? And we often say, let's put it out on the front. Let's move LAX out to Palmdale so that everyone schleps out there, or try and expand Ontario. San Diego has struggled for years with what to do with its downtown airport. A few years ago, there was development that had come up around Stapleton Airport in Denver, which is a major hub in the US, right? And the decision was made to actually move way, way out into the prairie and build a massive new airport that's a long way from the city that entails a huge amount of travel back and forth for people of Denver, okay? Because of that, ostensibly because it was a brownfield, they couldn't expand onto a military base. They now turned that into a park, so somehow they managed to mitigate that. They faced the same thing in Vancouver. In Vancouver, they had an inner area airport, and there was a lot of pressure to oppose its expansion. And what did they do? They looked at how much it would cost to relocate the airport, and it was so enormous. They went to the neighbors that lived in the area and said, you know what? A lot of warehousers would like to be right around the airport instead of residents. We'll buy you out and help you relocate. People said, absolutely not. I don't want to do it. There's nothing that can make me move. And it turns out that the last person voluntarily leaves at about 2.2 times the value of their home. So the person says, I will never leave. And you say, I'll give you $1.2 million for your $500,000 house. And they say, I'll take it. Not to be cold-hearted about it, but what they were able to do was actually buy out a bunch of neighborhoods. In some cases, help people who are neighbors relocate to be neighbors in a new area. They used a lot of that land that they then resold to UPS and other warehouses around that. They actually restored some wetlands, and they expanded their airport for about a third of the cost of relocating the airport. So instead of just saying, okay, neighbors, lump it, we've won this battle, they created a win-win situation by saying, yeah, these are beautiful neighborhoods, it's a tragedy, but relocating the airport is billions and billions of dollars. We're gonna buy out neighborhoods, we can expand this airport, we can do these other things, we're gonna restore some wetlands here, we're gonna buy all of that, and doing that is so much cheaper, and we're not just gonna pay them their fair market value through eminent domain, we're gonna make them happy. And we're gonna buy them out in a way that they are really happy about the decision. So people were able to actually pay cash for a new house and then have money left over for the retirement. They were happy with that. They didn't want to move, but we were able to pay what they could. We don't tend to think about those kinds of win-win situations, right? What we do is we negotiate this settlement, we say it was painful for everyone. It doesn't have to be painful for everyone. And we didn't need to pay all of that money to relocate Stapleton Airport. In downtown San Diego, there's just no win around that. We would never think about what it would take to kind of buy out and expand that. Because that's just not how we operate. We tend to kind of think in those ways. So,
San Diego was geographic.
That wasn't a good example. Yeah, that wasn't a good example. San Jose, maybe, or Burbank.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, I'm seeing the time is 3:00, and knowing that we like to answer in paragraphs rather than in sentences, I think it's probably time for us to close. Thank you. Reza, did you want to completely wrap? Okay. In one quick snippet here, I think we've really learned from Brian about focusing in on social interactions and economic transactions and looking not just at the means but the ends as well. We've really been paying a lot of attention to regional economies and agglomeration of firm location, speed and proximity, access to jobs, and also in this little last bit here, very important in terms of looking at the port communities and impacts as well. Professor Taylor gave us a very tangible thing that I think we can take away with is the idea of an accessibility index or measure that we could really add into our transportation planning and hopefully one day affect policy. And we also learned a lot about fish tacos and where is the best restaurant. One thing that I'm going to actually turn this for a 1 second answer is Matt Friedman had a question that I had, which many of you do, is when are the final reports for this going to be available? And particularly, Matt asks, he's here in headquarters, when will the San Francisco Bay Area data and analysis be available? In a sentence.
We're working hard to finish it by the end of the month so we don't get in trouble with the funder, but we're on track to try and finish it by the end of the month.
All right.
Or a day or two after that, but okay. Yeah, right about there.
All righty. Thank you.
And the LA data are available from the Haines Foundation website, and the UCCONNECT adds all the Bay Area data and then does some comparative of LA and in Bay Area.
Which reminds me that all four webinars, this was the last of the four that's been sponsored here through UCCONNECT, Caltrans, through Department of Transportation Planning and Research and Innovation. All four webinars, three of them now are online. The fourth one will be two, is probably also probably through Caltrans, but also through our website at ucconnect.berkeley.edu. So if you want to relive this one or watch some of the other ones, which deal with pedestrian and bicycle travel, big data, and what was the suburban office landscape. You can see us there and check us out on our YouTube channel. Reza, if you'd like to wrap us up.
Sure. I just want to thank you so much for this fascinating discussion. This reflects the value of transportation research. I hope my management are listening, and also the value of transportation and research dollars that are contributing to such research as this one. And so,
it's music to my ears. Yeah. I'll tell you that.
I tell you, today it was the concept of congestions were really intriguing, especially for those of us in transportation, because it's more than a concept or an issue. It's an existential kind of role in transportation. We constantly thinking how to provide access and choices, and yet in the process, we are making lots of decisions that may or may not contribute to that goal or objectives. And so this helps us to think more creatively and more innovatively in the process of transportation investment decision making. So thank you so much for being here. We thank you.
Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you.